right across Australia, this is Sunrise on 7. Now, live from Brekkie Central, Nat and Sherva.
Hello, thank you for joining us on Sunrise this Friday morning. Coming up on the show today, Guts and Glory, Dad Bods Unite. Australia's biggest rig competition is live.
But first to some breaking news overnight and the development in the stabbing of the Western Sydney bishop. A teenager is this morning officially facing terrorism charges over the incident. Let's go live to Liam Tapper in Sydney. Liam, he faces a maximum sentence of life imprisonment.
Good morning, Sherva. Yeah, he certainly does. The harshest penalty that we have here in Australia. This 16-year-old who allegedly stabbed Bishop Marmari Emmanuel on Monday night, he was charged yesterday afternoon by detectives in part of this joint counter-terrorism team with a number of agencies who come together to work against the worst of the worst criminals that we have here in Australia. Now, he does remain in hospital after undergoing surgery on his finger, so he will face court by bedside today. He will have that charge read out against him, but he's one of a number of growing teens who are allegedly committing terrorism offences, but also committing knife crimes, which has led to a calls from police here in New South Wales to come down on parents much harder when it comes to knife crime. They say that these parents, they have a role to play in how their children act and the things that they think as well. Of course, a similar case in America recently with Ethan Crumley. He committed a mass shooting and his parents have just been sentenced to 10 years imprisonment because it was deemed that they had a role to play in his mental state. But certainly a lot of questions to come out of this latest alleged terrorist attack here in Australia, Sherbo. The police commissioner, Karen Webb, along with the AFP commissioner, Reece Kershaw, will face the media at 8 a.m. this morning. So hopefully we'll get some more answers.
Yeah, we'll cover that throughout the morning. Thanks, Liam. Also in Sydney, and stores in Sydney's Westfield Bondi Junction will be allowed to reopen this morning after the deadly stabbing over the weekend that claimed the lives of six people. Retailers stayed shut yesterday when mourners were allowed into the centre for the first time, quietly paying their respects to the victims and their families. Extra security will reassure retailers and customers today with a large vigil planned on Sunday. An injured Westfield security guard, Mohammed Taha, has thanked the government for offering him permanent residency. He was injured by the killer's knife while trying to protect others. Taha also receiving a hospital visit from Pakistan's High Commissioner to Australia. Here's Nat.
Thanks, Sherbo. A Queensland man has been arrested, accused of heading a sophisticated cocaine importation racket, estimated to be worth $683 million. Live to Georgia Costi in Brisbane, Georgia. This is a big catch for police.
That's right, Nat. This is a huge arrest for the Australian Federal Police. A 36-year-old man from Aspley here in Brisbane, Daniel Roberts, is now behind bars. And officers will allege that he is the leader of a sophisticated crime syndicate. They say he is the man behind a failed importation of 900 kilograms of cocaine that's seen packages of the drugs wash up at several beaches right across the New South Wales coast. They say he's also responsible for a range of other serious drug importations with a street value of $683 million in just 1 year. And on top of that, he's now also been charged over two arson attacks and a shooting here in Brisbane. But Nat, the Federal Police say this is just the start. They say there are several other people involved in this syndicate and that it's only a matter of time before they too are brought to justice.
Okay, thank you, Georgia.
Let's get some more news now. Morning, Eddie.
Morning to you, Sherva. Morning, everyone. 60 recommendations made by a Queensland Youth Crime Inquiry have been revealed after the committee was prematurely dissolved. Let's go live to Sam Payne in Surfers Paradise. Sam, morning to you. What sort of reforms were they actually looking at?
Morning, Eddie. Pretty big reforms that could make actually a massive change to criminal activity and life in Queensland. They were actually, when the public saw them, they were welcomed because what they were quite radical. They included lowering the threshold for declaring serious repeat offenders, reviewing detention of children as a last resort, finding alternatives to locking minors in watch houses, urgently addressing housing shortages for vulnerable youth, and exploring children's court hearings at youth detention centres. But these are only from an interim report and they couldn't be agreed upon from the LNP and Labor Party. So at this point in time, after 6 months, hundreds of thousands of taxpayer dollars All the public have been left with is a wish list that no party could be agreed upon. And as we head into the state election in the coming months, we're sure that it will heat up this political debate, and local charities are just crying out for more support so they can make a change on the ground.
A huge issue in the state. Thank you, Sam. In a new sign of the national hospital crisis, surgery wait times are worse than they've ever been. Emergency departments are not able to treat a third of patients with life-threatening conditions on time. The new data from the Australian Medical Association says hospitals are at breaking point with overfilled wards, population-wide chronic disease and a crumbling workforce. All states are failing to meet the 4-hour emergency department treatment deadline too. A toddler is fighting for life after an horrific crash in Logan, south of Brisbane. A 3-year-old was being pushed in a stroller by her mum when the stroller was hit by a truck at Browns Plains. The truck driver, who's also a nursing student, was helping provide first aid to the young girl. Health ministers from around the country are gathering today to put forward an urgent plea to federal parliament to pass vaping laws. Let's go live to Rob Scott in Canberra. Rob, what are they calling for?
Morning, Eddie. Well, they say the proliferation of vapes risks another generation of Australians getting hooked on nicotine, and they want immediate action to protect them. The Albanese government actually already has legislation before Parliament that would ban the sale, supply, manufacture and the commercial possession of non-therapeutic vapes. But those laws, although they've passed the lower house, they are now stalled in the Senate. But with an estimated 1 in 6 high school students already vaping, health ministers from across the country meeting today, they want the federal parliament to urgently pass those laws. They say that vapes are dangerous and should not be allowed to be sold in convenience stores right next to chocolate bars. At the moment, nicotine vapes are already banned without a prescription, but this next step would see vape stores shut down. But the coalition is concerned that the laws would just fuel an explosion in the black market. Eddie?
Yeah, it's a huge issue for so many families. Thank you, Rob. Victorian mental health agencies have voiced their fears that anticipated state budget cuts could cut staffing numbers by up to 50%. Victorian Treasurer Tim Pallas is being pressured to rein in rising debt. The cuts, if implemented, will result in the mental health industry losing highly trained senior clinicians and experienced specialised staff members too. Footy fans have been placed on notice ahead of tonight's Crows match at Adelaide Oval with another round of train strike chaos looming. Last week, Port fans were left scrambling for expensive Ubers and taxis during similar industrial action. The Transport Department will put on extra buses to plug the hole, but 50,000 fans are expected to attend tonight's Crows clash with the Bombers. Melbourne police have launched a major search operation overnight for an elderly man who's missing. The 72-year-old was last seen in his home suburb of Clayton at 1:30 yesterday afternoon. Police say he's 165 centimetres tall and wearing this jacket pictured and red pants too. Anyone who sees him is urged to call police. China has lashed out at Australia after the Prime Minister announced $50 billion in defence spending this week.
We hope Australia will understand China's strategic intentions and abandon its Cold War mentality.
China also painted Japan as a Western pawn following its partnership with AUKUS. AFL fans will get a chance to bid on items that belong to living legend Nathan Buckley after he put 200 items from Collingwood up for collection. Let's go live now to Melbourne correspondent Tegan Dolling. It's all up for auction, Tegan. Why is he doing this?
Yeah, it seems like it's unfortunately a little bit against his will, to be honest, Eddie. This is all part of Nathan Buckley's split to his wife of 18 years. Everything is currently up for sale. More than $100,000 worth of his memorabilia all over his decades of playing career. Things like photos, signed autographs, and even some really special items of his. A couple in particular, one being the 2002 Grand Final Guernsey that he actually wore, and that was when he won that Norm Smith medal despite his team losing to Brisbane. That's expected to go for around $5,000. There's a footy back from 2002, which was signed by the umpires from his 200th game, and even some footy boots of his that he used to wear back in his playing day. Now, he actually, as part of this divorce, also had to buy back his own Brownlow medal and Norm Smith medal. We don't know how much he bought them back for, but they are back safely in his own pocket. Eddie, all of these items will be up for sale online on the 1st of May.
Thank you, Tegan. Kids under 16 years old are the targets of the majority of cyberbullying attacks. That age group made up 75% of complaints to the eSafety watchdog last year. More than 513-year-olds reportedly had been bullied online, and most common were nasty comments as well as offensive pictures and videos being shared. Kids also reported being contacted by fake accounts or even being impersonated online themselves.